Pete Daigle here, and today we're going to talk about refelting your Autoharp. It's a job that some people don't like to do, and if you don't like to do it, that's fine. Just send it to us, and we'll take care of it. But if you'd like to give this a try, that's what we're here to talk about today. You don't need many tools. You need something to mark with. You need a nice razor knife. I like these good heavy utility knives, the ones that we used to call sheetrock knives. They do a nice job. And a few other little things that I'll show you as we go. The first question, of course, is when do you need to change your felt? I'm going to try to show you a few bars here, and I'll put a white sheet behind them so you can hopefully see it a little bit. This bar has hardly been used. There's no dents or cuts in the felt, and it's definitely not in need of changing. And let's see here. This bar is beginning to dent a little bit. Those dents are not a bad thing. It means you are breaking in. Your felt is breaking into your string bed, and it's actually easier to play than when felt is brand new. Once you've got some nice dents in it, it actually is easier to play. This felt is being cut into by the strings, and once the strings start cutting into the felt, then you're working too hard to try to damp your strings, and it's time to refelt. Before you take your instrument apart, take a picture of your layout. That way, if the cat jumps up on the table while you've got your bars spread out and mixes them up, you'll be able to get them back together the way you need them to be. Sometimes on some of these old Oscar Schmidt bars and possibly other bars, you'll find when you take them apart, they have no marks on them. You don't know what that bar was. And like this one, once it's stripped, you don't know what that was supposed to be. So if they are not marked as you're taking them apart, mark them so that you know what chord that is. Before you cut your felt off of the bar, take a marker and mark the openings. I've done this with a magic marker just to make it very clear for the video. You can do it with a pencil and you can rub that mark off afterwards if you like, or you can leave the marks on there. There's only one bar where they'll show to the outside, so you can leave them on if you just want to have them on there for convenience for next time. Just mark the openings where all the openings for your strings are. And then it's time to cut that felt off. That's where the utility knife comes in. And for bars with a fixed button, like a Daigle or like most luthier bars, something like this, all this is a piece of wood with a big hole in it and pieces of router pad on both sides to help it keep from slipping. When you take a bar and put it in there, it will come up against there and give you something to come against so that you can cut this felt off. There's a variety of chord bars and chord bar material. Many of them are an extruded aluminum like this. They're reasonably easy to strip. The Daigle harp, which has all grain match laminated wood on top, is actually an extruded aluminum piece, and it's fairly easy. Most of the custom auto harps are wooden bars, and they're not hard, but just be careful that you don't cut into the bar with your knife. I like to use a bench vise like this. I have felt on both sides of the jaws so that I don't harm the bar, and then I like to get this right in front here. I like to get my knife fairly flat and put it right on top of that bar and cut straight back like this and use it kind of like a plane and strip that felt off of there. The bar does not have to be exactly clean, but it does have to be flat, so you want to get some of that residue glue off of there too until you have a nice flat surface. It doesn't have to be perfectly clean, but you want it to be flat. And then when you are ready and it's time to felt, this is already stripped back, but I actually want to show you a little trick, so I'm going to cut it off. When you're cutting felt off, it's nice to have a block of something good and solid. so that you can cut through it easily. And what I wanted to show you is a little trick that Bob Lewis showed me years ago, and that's to put your knife straight down on that backing that covers up the self-adhesive and pull back on it. What that does is it loosens your backing, so it makes it real easy to pull off. Otherwise, you can be in there trying to dig it off and makes it kind of a pain. Pull it off like this. Let gravity work for you. Get it started. Let gravity work for you. Use your fingers on your bar, pinch the bar, and then run it straight down the bar. What that does is that keeps that felt lined up on the bar so that it doesn't overlap, so that it doesn't stick out where it'll catch on other bars later. And then put it on your hard surface and cut it off at the other end. Now, a 15 bar Oscar Schmidt style bar, we let the felt hang off the ends. That's so when you put it back in place, it doesn't bang around and it doesn't slide around, doesn't make any noise, and it won't slide back and forth. On Daigle bars, it's pretty, the tolerance is pretty close where you have to cut it. You might have to actually put it in place to see that it's not coming down and hitting the comb that holds the bar in place, because that'll stop it from damping. Fairly close tolerance on the Daigles. Just check out how your bars work so that you can see exactly how close you have to cut that. Once it's cut, in the shop we have rollers that we roll these with, but you don't have that at home more than likely. But you can take a table, especially one like with a covering like this, and go like that with some pressure. It does two things. For one, it pressurizes that adhesive to your bar and it's going to hold for you. The other is, if you look close, it raises some fuzz on the top of that bar, which actually helps in the break-in period. It helps to damp your strings. Now, when you have that done and you have your marks on your bar, like we did here before, now you have a new felt on it. Now it's time to put this exactly in place on your Autoharp, where it goes on the Autoharp, and mark your strings. Mark the felt exactly where the strings are. Don't rely on the marks above now. They're just to get you in the right place. Now you mark it exactly where the string is before we cut these V-notches. Now to cut a V-notch, again, put it on something solid. And I go a little over a 16th of an inch on each side of that mark and push straight down with your knife on each side of that mark. And it cuts out that little chad. Now save that little chad for later, save a few of them, because you might need them. An important aspect of that cut is that your knife stays exactly perpendicular to the bar. If you twist your knife, your V-notch is going to be twisted and it'll damp the string instead of allow it to ring. So now you've got your V-notches cut. And you're ready to, once you've cut all the V-notches, you're ready to put it on your harp. And the last thing you want to do is try it out. Now, when you're trying them out, put them in exactly where they're going to go. And then visually check, especially down here at the base, that your strings are all clear. Okay, the bass strings vibrate, they move a lot. So they're going to need a little extra opening than the treble strings do. So make sure they have a wide enough opening, but that your strings that are supposed to be damped are actually damped. Once you've had that visual, try them out. If everything sounds good, you're in good shape. If, however, you have a one that is twanging the wrong string, that's where these little chads come in. You can actually take a little chad, glue it back into place where you have an opening where it shouldn't be, and then you can cut the opening where it should be, and you're back in line again. Now, we've got a pretty comprehensive written instructional on this on our website. Go to the how-to corner on our website, and also you'll find there a chart with a chords with the names of all the notes that should be open for each chord. We don't open the thirds as the very first note in the bass. We'll open the one or the five, but not the three or the seven in the bass, just as a practice, because it can sound funny as a chord otherwise. Otherwise, you're good to go, and once you're done, you're ready to play some music again. So thank you.